Hello and welcome to Digital Music 2.0. I'd like to thank Jorge and Telefonica for the kind invitation to let me introduce the conference. So who am I and who are we to talk to you about digital music? My name is Will Mills. I'm Director of Music and Content at Shazam. And Shazam is the world's biggest mobile discovery provider. We have over 125 million users worldwide. And these users tag over 3.5 million songs every day. And crucially, of these 3.5 million songs, we drive over 350,000 transactions every day. Here's some of the cool stuff we've done with artists ranging from the Beatles through to Lady Gaga to Linkin Park. We do a range of artist promotions, getting quite involved in money can't buy experiences, et cetera, et cetera. But I'm here to talk to you about the state of digital music in 2011, which the whole conference is about. So there are many opportunities and also challenges that lay ahead for digital music, and I'm going to go into these now. So in 2011, the total music business, as you probably know, has halved from 10 years ago when it was 34 billion to around 15 billion, which is a pretty dramatic drop. And the digital music piece of that is valued at about 4.6 billion. So digital's risen really rapidly from nothing really about 5 years ago up to about a third of the whole music industry. That's fantastic news. Digital's growing super strong. It's about 30%. It's growing up there. However, as you probably also know, that's not enough to offset the broader decline in the actual music business itself. This slide here sort of pretty much graphically represents that rise and fall. You can see the sort of rise of vinyl and tape to the heady days of CD, peaking in the late 90s there, and then, of course, into these uncharted waters where we are today with digital. And yes, this is being written as we speak now, this section. So the cloud, you probably all saw the announcement of Apple's launch of the cloud and also Google and Amazon's launch. And this seems to be very much the future of digital music, i.e. music where you can access it via the internet, all you can eat, et cetera, et cetera. And the current services proposed by those three players are pretty impressive. The Apple One uses scan and match technology to look at your music collection and put it into the cloud so you can access it all. However, it does feel that the music consumer with services like Spotify and Deezer and many others wants access to all their own music and also all the music in the world. If you look at the success of YouTube as a music site, which is by volumes of traffic the most popular music website in the world, that's because you can go on there and you can hear literally everything. So the cloud is a great start, but I definitely feel it is a start, and the kind of broader piece which seems to be a demand from consumers is the proverbial celestial jukebox with access to everything. So digital music in 2011, so what are the opportunities going back to the slide with the revenues? Well, there's 200 million iTunes account holders with credit card details, and there's roughly, this is an estimate, roughly around 300 million Amazon users. So this is some pretty rough maths, please excuse me here. So if 10% of both those customer bases were to spend around 100 bucks a year on music, that would equate to around 5 billion a year. The current model that's being proposed at the moment, which the Apple service is at, which is at around the $25 per year to access your own music collection, even if a much higher percentage, say 30% of both those customer bases, this is a theoretical model, that would still equate to around 3.7 billion. So there's a substantial opportunity there for sure. So what are the key trends in digital music? Well, you probably know that digital single sales are very, very high indeed. Lots of singles are selling over 10 million, or a few singles are selling over 10 million, and there's certainly a lot more than they sold when they were physical units. Albums obviously have fallen through the floor, unfortunately, in this new model, as consumers can cherry-pick which tracks they like. Subscription services are shifting music from being a good, something that you buy as a record or a CD as a download, to being very much a service that you access, like your mobile telephone bill or your gas bill. And these revenues, as I've just demonstrated, are pretty hard to model. And one of the key areas of opportunity, which we're going to go on to later on, is adding value around the whole actual music experience is going to be one of the biggest opportunities for the music business. This is, for example, services that add value to the actual recorded music piece, be that video, be that social, be that gig going, be that connecting with other people. And this is Kesha, who was the biggest selling single in 2010, who sold 12.8 million. So the opportunity. So there are around 2 billion people on the internet at the moment in 2011, and that's expected to more than double by 2020. So that's a huge increase in the addressable market for music services. And one of the key trends that's going to drive that increase in people onto the net is smartphone usage and adoption. This map here shows the rise and predicted rise in smartphones and also tablets. And you can see many analysts have predicted by 2013 that the phone will overtake the PC as the primary internet device. And due to the utility of mobile, that represents a very big opportunity. At Shazam, we've seen that if you catch people at the moment of inspiration around music, where they've heard a great track and they've Shazammed it, and you give them a very quick and easy way to purchase that, you can drive a ton of sales. And I think there'll be a lot of more services that tap into that utility of mobile, which we'll get onto some more in a moment. And of course, as phones become cheaper in volume, they will be cheaper than the conventional PCs, so that will obviously help spread penetration around the world as well. So just to talk a bit about smartphones and their actual sort of ecosystem. The phone is a very emotive device. It's the one thing you take out of the house with you when you go, along with your wallet and keys. It's the thing you always have on you, and now obviously it's a mini computer with billing and many other kind of services involved. One of the key ones related to music, which is pretty interesting, is location. Obviously, Foursquare have made a dramatic impact there, and Facebook Places is also doing that. There's also, in Shazam, when you Shazam a track, it will also look at your location and pull up local gigs to you, and there are other services doing that as well. This is more of a bit of fun at the moment. No one's really worked out how this is going to work as a business, but the accelerometer, which is the piece of the phone where you move it around and wave it around, there's a couple of cool apps, one that's called Air Drummer, and another one around guitars. And although it seems a bit of a crazy concept, basically, how if you give consumers a way to interact with music more, that definitely represents another further opportunity for creating value. And NFC, or near-field communication, this one's actually already being iterated on and is out in the market. In the Isle of Wight Festival, which is in the UK, MasterCard, who are a very big credit card company, have given you these wristbands, which they've trialed there, and basically you can buy your drinks with them, you can buy your food at the festival, and of course that proxy will obviously move into the phone as well. And that's very exciting if you're a festival organizer, because you'll better make a lot of money, I imagine. And this one's more, again, it's very early days, but AR, or augmented reality. There's a Leo, who are the market leaders in this, have an app where you can wave it around your reality and it will add things on. This is one of the Beatles in Abbey Road in London, and it will bring the Beatles up there. And you can do that the same at Battersea Power Station and get that Pink Floyd album cover as well. So there's all very exciting stuff that's been done with mobile, and there's going to be a lot of businesses that emerge out of this that create value. So technology, artists, and fam, where are we there? So since the day dot of the music industry, or even before the music industry, there's only ever been the artist on one side and the fan on the other. And traditional music business, there's been record labels, publishers, distributors, bricks and mortar, retailers of music in between those guys. Now, obviously, the internet has kind of completely shrunk that gap between artist and fan. And what you're seeing now is that you have to be completely engaged as an artist with your audience through Twitter, through Facebook, through YouTube, through SoundCloud. That's a picture of Calvin Harris in the studio with Kylie tweeting it as he's actually writing the song. That's a dead mouse track, who's an electronica artist who had over 1,000 comments on one of his tracks. So the relationship between the artist and fan is very much a bi-directional, very close relationship where the fans are very much shaping the whole music as it comes out. And that's only going to continue. And you're seeing a lot of A&R people will only sign artists that can actually really execute in this world and know how to engage a fan base and communicate with them, because that is the new reality. So artist and fan, music production. I'm guessing some people, who in here is a record label or a music creator? That's quite a few. Who in here is a student or at college? None. Well, music, for those who create music, you probably know that the tools to create music have come down in cost dramatically. It's never been cheaper to write, to record, to mix, to even professionally master your music. So these tools have never been cheaper for people to get hold of. And what does that mean for the distribution? Well, you have great services like SoundCloud and MySpace, which is obviously a little bit on the decline. That can get your music out there to your fans. You've got other services like Topspin, Zimbalam, TuneCore, who can get your music onto iTunes and Spotify and all these other guys. You can do all that yourself, but what you can't do necessarily is the hard part, which is get yourself an audience. And that's obviously the key challenge, which still, in today's digital environment, still remains. So getting heard as an artist now, even in the sort of today's world of blogs and internet and everything else, it's still very much almost controlled by the traditional media. So 85% of people's music discovery comes via the radio. And the old methods really remain as breaking as an artist. There's quite a few examples of a kind of so-called middle class of artists who are creating a very good living, making their own music and selling the direct-to-fan route. There's this guy, Jonathan Coulton, who's allegedly making $500,000 a year, and very well to him. But you don't hear him on the radio in Barcelona, you don't hear him in London. And to break big as an artist, you still require a significant amount of investment, be that from a management company or also from a record label. So this is just one example of artists and fan getting closer together, which uses Shazam. So recently in the UK, there was an unreleased track that was used on a popular chicken restaurant, KFC, as advertisement. And it was a great advert, really emotive. And it had a ton of people Shazamming it. And it went straight to number one in our chart, which is in a lot of trade publications. And we had a significant amount of record labels ring us up and go, hey, do you know what this track is? Where can we get hold of it? Because it wasn't released. It did eventually get picked up by Universal and enter the charts traditionally. But the key point here is that these guys, through Shazam and also through other internet and mobile services, they could have got that music out and pretty much sold it direct. So the actual old barriers have broken down completely almost in many ways. So what will the music companies of the future look like? Well, management companies are very much taken on the roles of record labels. A management company these days will fund the recording, they'll make the video, they'll get the artist out on tour, they'll be doing all this stuff. And record labels, conversely, on the other side, have also started to take on the functions of the management companies. Record labels have got their own management company divisions, they're buying up management companies, they're doing a whole ton of stuff. And clearly, the value of recorded music is going to be around the whole 360 music experience. And that's definitely where the music companies of the future will probably be heading, from being just record companies that deal with the recording of the music. Video is probably going to be one of the key areas in music that along with social, that people are going to create a lot of value out. This is Rebecca Black. I don't know if she was big in Spain, maybe not, but she was probably for all the wrong reasons. She got a huge amount of video plays, 165 million, which puts it in the top 10 music videos of all time. And that's for a video that cost $2,000 to make. So hardly anything, and it got right up there. And probably more exciting from a business, Vivo, who are a service for music fans and also a great service for music creators, because what they're trying to seek to do is to raise the value of music video by premium advertising to make more value out of music for everyone concerned. This is one of the big areas as well that's going to be pretty interesting for music, which is convergence. So this is when you're watching a TV show, but as most people watching TV shows, I see a lot of tablets and smartphones here, probably also have their tablet or smartphone out and are tweeting or somehow engaging with the show as it goes on. And we're doing quite a lot of that stuff at Shazam at the moment with our Shazam for TV vertical. And we've done two music shows in the US, one called Platinum Hit and another one called Glee. So you're watching the show, it doesn't have to be music per se, it can be audio or sound effects. You can Shazam the show and you'll get back a result that will enable you to engage with the show and also buy the digital music as well. So, in summary, it's never been easier to write and produce music and also video. The tools have never been cheaper or more accessible, and getting it out there has never been easier either. However, it seems to be as hard as ever to break as an artist, and those old kind of methodologies remain about trying to cut through as an artist. Access to music and also access to artists seems to be very much what consumers want and also be willing to pay for. And with the increase in the number of people on the internet, on all these new channels through smartphones, and other methods of payment. These are going to be ways that new music services create and drive a lot of value for music as a category in total. And that's me done. That's me if you want my email or to follow me on Twitter. Thank you very much.